So I don't want to take up too much time because I think it's more interesting that we have a conversation. But there are four points that I want to start with. And the first one is to take a step back a little bit and realize that AI isn't the only fruit. There are lots of other trends, drives of change that are shaping the world of work and have been for centuries and will continue to do so. And when we think about what the future of work is going to look like and the skills that we're going to need, we need to consider those as well. And this is everything from demographic trends to globalization to political choices. And this actually makes the question of what the future of work is going to be like and the skills we need complex and difficult. And I think one of the challenges, particularly with some of the work that has been done to talk about automation and AI and the impact of work, is it reduces the conversation down to something that is quite simplistic, whereas actually the conversation is very complex. And so this brings me on to my second point, which is a little bit of a plug for Nesta work. And that's that we need better ways of dealing with this complexity. We need better ways, smarter ways of understanding what the future of work is going to look like, what kind of skills we're going to need to be able to be competent within that, and then how we train and how we organize labor accordingly to make sure that you know, people have work and that the economy functions. And at the moment, we don't really have very good ways of doing this. But Nesta is obviously gearing the way here. And one of the things that Nesta has been trying to do is think about how we bring foresight and futures, a methodological approach to looking at the future and dealing with that uncertainty, along with data, information, analytics that we have now about the history of work and what trends might shape work and how they're going to shape work, to try and give better predictions around what the future of work might be like and therefore what kind of skills we need. And so this is some work that we've been doing over the last couple of years. But one of the things that we're really interested in doing with this is to think about how we take that information from, you know, what are quite, I guess, academic reports, and make that usable, not just for governments to make decisions, not just for companies to understand what the future of their labour market is going to look like, but also for people. How do people prepare themselves for that future workspace, for those future skills? So can we create what we're calling labour market intelligence, then, for people on the ground and also for governments and for industries? And this is something we're really keen on working on and continuing to do, and using data from things like job adverts to try and get better information, get better intelligence out there. So that's the second point. Third point I want to make, again, is zooming out a little bit onto this conversation about automation and AI. And the way that we have this conversation is very much a kind of, you know, one-way power asymmetry. We talk about it in the sense that automation is coming, technology is coming. And beyond AI, we talk about this with all sorts of different technologies, that this is going to happen to us. And it reminds me of the in 1933, in the Chicago World's Fair, there was a tagline that said, science finds, industry creates, and man conforms. And this is the kind of conversation that we generally have around AI and technology, is that we're going to be subservient to whatever somebody else does. And I think the most important thing here, and this has been raised a little bit so far, is we actually have a lot more agency over this than we give ourselves credit for. And, you know, and we do have to realize that it's not just routine jobs that AI is potentially going to be able to start doing. And I think it's important to say that even creativity here is a space that's not free from impacts of AI. There's some really interesting tools and really interesting work that's going on that is actually trying to build systems that can be creative, but also help us to be creative. But I think the important thing is to remember that we do have agency over this. And one of the examples of this is the existence of what are called high-performance work practices within jobs. So if you look at routineness, and you look at the ability to automate routine jobs, it is these high-performance work practices, which are a range of things from things like task discretion, so being able to decide when you do a task, autonomy at work, teaching, mentoring, a lot of kind of soft skills-related stuff, creativity, cognitive skills-related work. And these actually help protect jobs in terms of routineness against automation. And when you look across OECD countries at which countries have higher rates of these high-performance work practices, unsurprisingly, it's countries like Denmark, Sweden, those kind of Nordic countries that tend to come quite high. The UK comes about average. But it shows you that job and organizational design have a huge impact on this, and we have control over that. It is not just the market that is shaping the way jobs are designed and what you do in your job. So we do have more control. My last point, again, is slightly separate to this debate, but it's a bigger one, and one that I think we need to have a bigger conversation around. And that is what really happens further in this future. So we're talking about potentially really big disruption to skills, work, the way we function within society effectively. At the scale pretty much that perhaps hasn't been seen since the Industrial Revolution, jobs and skills and how the makeup of these jobs hasn't really changed that much since the Industrial Revolution, at least very gradually. There hasn't been major disruption. But potentially we're on the cusp of major disruption. And if we, you know, if we believe some of these percentages, the 47% of jobs that are going to be automated away or disappear, there's going to be huge disruption. And I think one of the really fundamental impacts that this has on society is not necessarily on joblessness, because we should, you know, and part of the fear is not necessarily losing your job, but what happens when you don't have a job? How do you survive? How do you function in society? But I think there's a deeper debate here, and that's what is the role of work personally and in society? When you go to a party and you talk to people and you introduce yourselves, the way you introduce yourselves is what do you do as a vocation? It becomes part of your identity, part of who you are. Even though we measure social economic status is linked to jobs, so what if that starts to disappear? And you know, even at the moment, that's radically changed from what it's been in the last 20, 30 years. So the way we start to think about ourselves personally, this is one of the major things, major fundamental things that will change in the next 50 years at least. And we need to have a better conversation about how we address that balance, because the mental health issues associated with this change are huge. So that's where I want to leave it. I think these are questions that we should come back to, but I'm looking forward to an interesting debate.
Harry Armstrong, thank you.